Welcome to this audio transcribed podcast of part one of an interview with Derek Kirkham Sensei, the SKU Director of Coaching, by Rachel Rieko Murakami. First published in the SKU Quarterly Magazine, August 2010, issue number 40.
Today it is my great pleasure to be in conversation with Derek Kirkham Sensei, who has been my mentor since I started to practice karate at university. Welcome, Sensei. Quite often we hear how things were very different years ago in this country. How was it when you first got involved in the fighting arts?
Well, I was born in 1956, and the martial arts were at that time still a very mystical and an exotic form of fighting art in this country. To put things into perspective, Gichin Funakoshi only died on April 26, 1957, and the JKA worldwide expansion was no more than a hopeful plan. The British Karate Federation had just been formed 1956-1957. Attitudes in society have altered greatly since I started to study karate. They have been corrupted by the instrument which served karate so well in its popularization and allowed it to grow to where it is today. I refer specifically to the film industry. Over the years, they have distorted the public's view and perceptions of karate. The public now have such a wide choice of sporting activities to participate in, and all sports have greater accessibility and affordability to the general public these days than when I was a youth. Sadly, karate classes today are merely just another activity choice for the public to participate in. However, karate was looked upon and treated as a lifestyle choice more than a sporting pastime in the early days, and not wishing to sound like some gung-ho old-timer, but training was a more brutal and more readily accepted to be a brutal and austere activity in the early days. I'm not for a moment advocating it as a prerequisite to ensuring or maintaining a degree of seriousness of purpose in one's practice or as a method of achieving high technical standards. I'm just saying how it was at that time. In the early days, karate was nowhere near as well known or popular, nor was it taken for granted. Most martial arts were practiced by very serious enthusiasts of an older average age. Some clubs were run by yellow belt students in the church village hall. Karate was just not that readily available in those days, unlike it is today. And sadly, there was still a hangover of post-war anti-Japanese feeling in some parts of society.
So how and where did you start your training?
My study and practice of the fighting arts started with boxing at the King Street Junior School. We took things very seriously indeed, although we hardly had any equipment to speak of. We would box stood on those brown harsh coconut mats that resembled a flat scrubbing brush, and they really did feel like one too, especially when one's bare knees came into contact with them. They were also used for other activities elsewhere in the school, so two kids per mat were nominated to transport them. Because of their weight, we would have to drag them to position them in the hall every time we needed them for boxing. And the cloud of dust generated from those heavy mats as we flopped them into position, well, the dust cloud was enough to choke a horse or clog the lungs of any would-be young athlete. The gloves were a similar horror story. Not only were they a scarce commodity and very old, but they were those huge brown leather gloves, approximately three times the size of the hands that were flapping around inside them. It took all of one's strength to lift him as tiny juniors. The only bonus was that as a junior we were always listed to fight first. This meant that the inside of the gloves was still dry, assuming that it was warm weather and they had dried out from the day before. In other words, as you progressed, if you were an older boy, then you would have to fight at the end of the training session, and the gloves had been used by at least six other people before you that day, and in winter they were wet, smelly and sweaty. The lumpy, uneven gloves were filled with the now outlawed coarse hair as padding. And as the age of the gloves were considerably older than we were, then the leather that had worn so thin allowed the spiky horsehair inside him to poke through the wafer-thin leather. We were more in danger of being speared in the eye with the rogue horsehair than we were of making a knockout blow on our opponents, as our hands didn't fill the gloves adequately. This led to impatience and to bare-knuckle sparring that was frowned upon. but without enough equipment and set training times, then we had next to no choice. Looking back, we didn't feel hard done by, simply as we knew no better in those days. Then I had judo lessons whilst I continued with my boxing. The Warrington Judo Club was based in Lowshers Lane, Warrington. In reality, it was a wooden drafty shed type of a hall, but to us kids the dojo was a mystical space. The club had a great reputation and had been established since 1952. It was the first time I had seen a matted area with a canvas-covered canopy for practice. Although judo was very different to boxing and was equally enjoyable, there were quiet mutterings from some students in both the judo and boxing camps that there was something called karate out there. Karate already had a following, and it was trying to firmly establish itself here in the UK. It was supposed to be an exciting blend of kicking, punching, and throwing. So as kids, we speculated in the inevitable comparisons of which is the best fighting art. However, it took me my training lifetime to appreciate that the valuable knowledge I gained during my boxing and judo study was not time wasted, but were an alternative climbing route to reach the same mountain peak. Also, that each and every martial arts, in their own right, hold many secret gems and individual characteristics that are very effective in the hands of a dedicated and diligent practitioner of that art. While the less than objective, overzealous, and partisan claims that were made by some enthusiasts that the chosen fighting art was the best was commonplace, it was in reality merely erroneous and rash claims to say that any martial art is all round the best.
When did you first become involved in karate?
It was in 1965 that I first saw karate. I was 9 years old, which was way too young in those days to be considered to start training, as the acceptable age was considered to be around 16 years old by most of the clubs. There was a demonstration and training session run by Vernon Bell at the Liberal Club in my hometown. He had a 22-year-old young man with him, a brown belt, by the name of Andy Sherry. Bear in mind that this was not Shotokan Karate, but was Yoseinkan Karate under the direction of the British Karate Federation. This was before the split and the foundation of the KUGB in 1966. At that age, I didn't understand about and frankly wasn't interested in styles and the politics of organizations. Nor did I realize that in Vernon Bell, I was watching the man who in 1966 would introduce the JKA instructors Mr. Cassie Wyatt, Mr. Kanazawa, Mr. Enoida, and Mr. Shirai to this country. Vernon Bell later would rightly be known by many as the father of British karate. I did know, however, that I loved what I saw and I was in awe of and so excited by it, and that I just had to know more. I continued to follow up with when I heard of any events within traveling distance that would allow someone as young as me to be there.
So what did you do then?
Well, as I was too young for regular karate lessons, and on the rebound, I went to a wrestling club that was run by the great Ted Legs Batley. He held it in the annex of the local Victorian swimming baths at that time. Remember that things were not so well publicized or talked about in those days. So much so, that to my great surprise when I started wrestling, I didn't realize that there was a young man who trained there who went to the same school as I did. He was a much senior student to me, and he would later turn professional at the age of 16. He held a long career in the sport, and later became a world champion wrestler. His name is Steve Wonderboy Wright. He was a fast, clean wrestler of high technical ability, and he was one of Ted Batley's top fighters. I enjoyed the wrestling very much, but there was something missing for me.
Did you give up your interest in karate at this time?
No way. As karate was always there in my mind and was my true passion ever since the day that I had seen that first Vernon Bell demonstration. Karate was in short supply locally, so much so that I remember having to travel by bus as a child all around the north of England upon receiving the slightest of whispers that there was a karate demonstration, or even on the smallest chance to see more of this karate. I fondly remember regularly discussing and swapping details with my close friend the late Chris Finch about people and places that were holding a karate session. People like Vernon Bell, Yoseikan, Terry Wingrove, and Harry Benfield. Some of the sessions were exactly like today, some held great validity to one's search while others were less so.
Was Chris a contemporary of yours?
He was slightly older than me, but yes, we were both very enthusiastic karate devotees, who were simultaneously searching for the right fighting art at the same time. Chris practiced karate until he later discovered Aikido, which was after he had a period of flirtation with jiu-jitsu, but he never lost his passion and interest for karate. Aikido, however, was the perfect blend for him to go alongside his chosen career as a physical therapist. He managed to elongate my competitive karate fighting days by several years with his healing skills. There was one major drawback of a visit to his clinical practice, and that was during the treatment session, when I was on his treatment table, immobilized and totally at his mercy. I was subjected to the animated reruns of fights and training sessions that we had both experienced when we were younger men.
You sound like you tried many different fighting arts when you were younger.
Looking back over at what I thought was a rather nomadic period of existence at the time, I now acknowledge that I was gaining a wealth of experience and skills from various fighting arts in my early years in pursuit of the right fighting art for me. I didn't realize that I would go on to utilize that knowledge in my karate study and teachings later. It has also made me more appreciative of the valid input that can be gained from the study of other martial arts.
How did you get involved in Shotokan karate, your chosen martial art, and the one that you are best known for?
I had been training and traveling around the region for some time looking for any demonstrations or open sessions at clubs that would allow younger students to attend. I didn't know at the time, but I was experiencing various styles and in the presence of many of the top instructors of the day. But I did know that I was merely filling in time until I reached an age where a club would accept me as a full-time member. During that time, however, there was little opportunity, unlike today, for younger students, as the average karate car was so much older then than today. In the meantime, a local club had started up, but they had a strict no-child membership policy. I understand that this child exclusion policy may be viewed as a strange concept these days, when some clubs are now actively seeking and accepting students as young as 4 and 5 years old. Which is something that I still have strong views upon. But that was the way it was then, and on many occasions since I have had reason to think, thank God for that policy. Anyhow, as enthusiastic teenagers, my cousin, a good friend of mine, and myself all enrolled for Shotokan karate lessons locally. This was very early in the 1970s, when the KUGB were themselves still young, having been formed in 1966. And as they were the only available Shotokan karate game in town, we immediately signed up. The club was itself in a period of transition and was about to come under the full-time instructional guidance of its founder, Roger Spencer, who was then a newly graded brown belt. Roger was not very tall, but he was very strong indeed. He was an exceedingly determined and powerful karateka. He formed the club when he was a yellow belt, and at that stage he used to invite brown belts down from other clubs to instruct, and the gradings were taken with Mr. N. Oida at Colin Williams' dojo over in Chester, Charlie Naylor's dojo in St. Helens. This was not unusual for that time. He ran the dojo adhering strictly to the formula of the Japan Karate Association's 3 Ks, Kihon, Kata, and Kumite. The training was very prescriptive, yet it was a highly beneficial grounding and was the best preparation that any karate student could ever wish to acquire. The intensity was high impact, and there was absolutely no room in the schedule for anything less than 100% concentration, perspiration and commitment during those training sessions. And for that I am genuinely and truly grateful to Roger for. Kime and speed focused heavily, no pun intended, at the club after one had reached brown belt. Ikan Hisatsu definitely was the aim, and I can still remember being impressed by the speed of Roger's Gyakusuki and his ability to switch on the Kime. Instructors such as him all around the country were the true backbone of Karate Do and were instrumental in a big way in the development of karate in this country as a result of their raw enthusiasm, dedication and love of the art. As the interest of my cousin and friend waned, they both dropped by the wayside, but my hunger seemed to increase exponentially. The club had a strong traditional theme with a no-competition approach, but I was hungry to experience this aspect of karate. By this time, I was old enough and had passed my driving test, which meant that I was then able to get around the country and train with many more people. This newfound mobility had another bonus for me, as I was able to drive myself to venues nationwide when visiting instructors came over from Japan. It was much easier for me to gain a further access and experience.
I have heard you say many times before that the person who is the most innovative is the man who borrows from the most sources. So, was that the basis for your have Gewill travel approach to your studies?
Yes, sort of, but always remember that there is no one man who has all the answers to another man's questions. I got involved in karate in a period when even the most basic of equipment, like karate suits, were difficult to buy locally, unlike today, and there were no videos or DVDs, and the internet had not yet been invented. I found one of the disadvantages, however, of traveling around to all those clubs and renowned instructors was that it sadly made me very aware of the political nature of martial artists. Looking back, some experiences were quite hostile and were straight out of a kung fu movie. Nevertheless, I was personally prepared to put politics aside, and I continued to learn from as many sources as I could, just increasing the depth and width of my knowledge base. It was during that time that I had become to admire greatly the contrasting qualities of both Mr. Kanazawa, who was the JKA's representative here in the UK, and he was the KUGB's chief instructor, along with his assistant who would soon become his replacement. I refer to Mr. Inoueda. Mr. Kanazawa also had Mr. Asano, who was an assistant JKA instructor until he formed the UK branch in Nottingham in 1974 of Mr. Kanazawa's new group. Of course, the circumstances surrounding the split from the JKA to start his new group named the SKI would differ greatly depending upon which camp one was listening to. But no matter what version of the story one wants to believe, it didn't alter jota the obvious outstanding ability of Mr. Kanazawa's and Mr. Inoueda's karate skills. And that's all that mattered to me, as a member of the KUGB and therefore a member of the JKA at the time. I must admit that soon after the SKI split happened, I quickly learned that it was for the best if I did not wear a karate suit or belt that carried the JKA logo in it when I was visiting an SKI dojo, as initially it presented its own challenges, as one would be a self-nominated target for the evening until they got to know you better. I benefited greatly from this journeyman approach to my karate study, and I was fortunate that at the Warrington Shotokan Karate Club, which was my regular training club, did not frown upon my training with other clubs, because that was exactly what Roger did himself when he was finding his way.
Politics tend to get in the way these days, in many martial art. Was it the same then?
I'm afraid so. And ironically, history has just continued to repeat itself. For example, the acrimonious split of the KUGB from the JKA after the death of Mr. Inoueda. Nowadays, politics in karate is prevalent, and politicians worldwide are as highly strung as any finely tuned violin. So with so many groups, too many to mention by name, from around the globe that are laying claim to the JKA name, it was hardly surprising that the lawsuits for ownership of the JKA brand after the death of Mr. Nakayama were being thrown about with gay abandon. This in turn led to further splits even from within the ranks of the high-ranking Japanese satellite groups themselves. There is a palpable undercurrent of hidden resentment that is bubbling up through the inscrutable public zen face between some rival organizations today, as they try to bolster their membership, even to the point that some groups don't in practice encourage inter-organizational cooperation. It seems to be that every decade or so there will be a new outbreak of organizational splits by the new generation of instructors who are coming of age. This isn't to say that more organizations is a bad thing. But I must highlight, if no inter-organizational communication or interaction takes place, then too often, some of the original concepts and techniques may be lost or altered slightly each time a split takes place as a result of the instructor's personal preferences and due to the differing opinions on interpretation. While splits of course spoil the utopian ideal of maintaining the original concept of training under one Shotokan banner, instructors will make decisions that are based on what is best to allow themselves and their students the freedom to grow and follow the path that is of most interest to them at that time. That's why some groups strictly practice karate as a traditional form of martial art, while others focus only on the sporting, competitive aspects, and some are merely interested in presenting karate as a way to keep fit or as a means of self-defense. The worst misuse of a resource and example of how petty politics in the martial arts is an irrelevance, a totally unnecessary evil, and is guilty of the systematic undermining of other karateka and or organizations in the related media and nowadays on the web. I believe that people who participate in this behavior have been nicknamed as trolls. A few years back there was a handful of bitter and twisted politicians in positions of prominence whose aim seemed to be to raise the self-esteem, their profile, and their membership upon the back of unjustly being abusive towards other organizations, or of anyone with opinions and methodologies that differed from their own point of view. But isn't the freedom to choose which route to take upon the very interesting journey of martial arts study the very thing which makes the martial arts such a fascinating pursuit and gives it its worldwide appeal? By now I shouldn't be, but even last week I was surprised to see how things seems to have got worse, when I read a barrage of ongoing derogatory comments all made by the same person. This lone assassin seemed to manage to have a controversial and diametrically opposed opinion on every single topic that was in a particular publication. He managed to argue with at least 10 different article authors from around the world who collectively covered the complete spectrum of philosophies within karate. This deplorable display was brought to my attention by one of my senior students. Totally confused, he asked me, "Surely if the 10 authors represent all of the available approaches, then how can this one person argue with everyone?" I laughed and paused for a moment and replied, "If his aim is to appear as being Mr. Knowledgeable, then this self-acclaimed go-to guru has failed, as he has shot himself in the foot. It is my firm belief that in the future, organizations will downsize and clubs will return to the ways of the past and therefore avoid being trapped by the negatives of the current organizational model. I believe that they will follow the model adopted by the Shotokan Karate Union."
Tell us a little more.
The Shotokan Karate Union model is based on being a consortium. It's a coming together whilst retaining independence. It's a coalition of like-minded members worldwide, who are free to run their own affairs with zero political interference. This allows them to follow the path best suited to the specific needs, yet at the same time, they are in communication with others who are willing to share ideas in a non-hostile, non-competitive atmosphere, where they don't fear to express their opinions and their understanding of their studies with others. Because the Shotokan Karate Union does not have a designated chief instructor, we have a committee of senior members and a director of coaching. Therefore, there is no political jostling for position. The consortium was a concept that was the aim at the foundation of the organization. It seems to have worked very well thus far, as we have passed our 25th anniversary in 2010. When we were founded in 1985, we started a few projects, one being Project 2000, which was a 15-year plan for the organization's advancement. Another was the Coaching Award Scheme, both of which were successful and far surpassed our expectations. We have individual associate members worldwide, even in your home city in Japan, yet we still retain regionalized control over the day-to-day running of affairs.
What are the biggest changes you have experienced?
Martial arts have changed for sure, but the world has changed too. People in general today seem more impatient and require instant, guaranteed and tangible gratification from karate. They demand success not in proportion to their efforts, but in return for their membership dollar. And it is this short-sightedness, this materialistic attitude change, which is of most concern, as some organizations that have observed the shift are capitalizing upon it, by diluting or worse, as in certain cases even ditching altogether the traditional ways, merely as a business strategy for attracting more members. It's the move towards trends such as this that are detracting from and depriving new starters today from experiencing the true benefits that traditional practice has to offer. Since that first exposure to Vernon Bell's karate demonstration in 1965, my conclusion has taken me a lifetime to arrive at, and it is that the study of karate is a lifelong endeavor. It is said that the destination is of secondary importance to the experience of the journey itself, and therefore, my belief is that Shotokan karate is the everyday study in pursuit of technical excellence and self-improvement. Whilst karate, society, attitudes, and ourselves have all developed, changed, grown, and simply got older, and as none of the aforementioned variable elements have stood still during those 45 years, then the understanding of and the mastery of any martial art can only be described as a constant, ongoing, and changing struggle, a journey, but a journey that has been most beneficial to me personally in so many ways, none more so than through the experiences I have had and the good friends worldwide that I have made during my long journey.
So what is next for your journey?
Ask me something easier. I plan to continue with my personal study and face the challenges that karate throws one every day, and as a result of recent personal events, I have had my enthusiasm to revisit neglected areas of study rekindled. I have started a couple of projects that I intend seeing through to completion, which will keep me quite busy.
Having studied with you for many years, Sensei, I would like to thank you for your patience and for your frankness during this interview, and I look forward to hearing more details of the projects that you are working on in due course.
It has been a pleasure, Rachel. You're very welcome. On a personal note, may I wish you well for the birth of your first baby. I hope afterwards that you will return to your karate study, as you have a wonderful talent and you will be greatly missed.
先生どうもありがとうございまして。
I would like to thank all the SKU members who have joined us for the first time, and likewise for our regular listeners to the SKU podcast. I strongly recommend that you take the time to listen to part two of this interview. Steve Redburn looks deep into the background stories behind some of Kirkham Sensei's experiences. This was an audio transcribed podcast on behalf of SKU Podcasts.